always believed in miracles. Yeah! I'm standing with the three biggest miracles in my life here tonight. And tonight we've been delivered another one. Good is Australia.
Yes, a miracle indeed. If you believe the polls for the last 2 years, Scott Morrison credited quiet Australians for his shock victory over Labor. Well, they certainly piped up on Saturday, giving the Liberal Party another term, despite the chaos and disunity of the past few years. It even looks as though the Liberals may win 77 seats, which will give them a majority government. Peter Fitzsimons, Sydney Morning Herald columnist, is with us this evening. Tēnā koe, welcome to Q&A and thanks for your time. Were you surprised?
Stunned. Completely stunned, like most of Australia, I think including most of those in the government. And I can't overstate, I mean, for the last 3 years, poll after poll after poll showing Labor Party well ahead, and there was sort of total dysfunction on the part of the government. There were allegations of bullying, there were people pulling the ripcord, there were leadership coups. I mean, it was just went on and on, and everybody thought that the Libs are going to lose, and then the polls closed at 6 p.m. We turn on the news across the country. Exit polls showed 52-48. I think it was 48.5, 51.5. Mm. Exit polls showing Labor. And then, you know, I had a party at my house for maybe 40 or 50 people. Bottom left-hand corner, predictions. First one prediction was LNP, Liberal National Party 10, ALP 1. So you go, what? And then as the night went on, it was just extraordinary. And it was like, the feeling was a bit like the Trump election in 2016, where people just, the people around me at least, simply couldn't believe it. But I think, to be fair, across the country, whatever your political stripes, absolutely nobody saw it coming.
How did the coalition do it?
That is a very good question. There's no doubt that the Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, campaigned very, very well. He was not only the conductor, he was pretty much the saxophonist, the trumpeter, he was on drums, he was everywhere. We didn't see anybody else. We had a million dead fish at Menindee, infamously, in January of this year. We didn't see the Environment Minister for dust. We saw a little bit of the Treasurer, Josh Frydenberg, but it was really very close to a one-man show. And Scott Morrison was just in every state, every day, going to every electorate, always smiling, always, g'day mate, have a meat pie. You know, like he campaigned very well. Personally, I admired the big ideas, if I can put it like that, that Bill Shorten put out there. But the absolute truth, the absolute difficult truth is the Australian electorate, one way or another, never quite warmed to Bill Shorten. I mean, there wasn't a personal like. We 2 days before the election, when we lost the great Bob Hawke, I mean, he was beloved by the people. And a lot of people thought, on Twitter, there was a handle, Do It For Bob. A lot of people thought that that would add 2 points to the Labor Party. Well, if it did, they were a long way behind because it finished up with the Labor Party about a point behind.
Yeah, this is the thing, isn't it? Twitter isn't the real world. Do you think that perhaps some in Australia are waking up to a bit of a disconnect between the elites in Sydney and Melbourne and working class people in places like Queensland and Tasmania?
It is quite, you can hear me speaking now. I'm speaking from the bubble. There's a bubble all around me because I am on Twitter and I do live in just north of the Sydney Harbour Bridge. And, you know, so I don't, look, I connect with people all over Twitter and all the rest of it and in my newspaper columns, and I'm getting emails from people all the time, and I'm travelling all over the country and I'm talking to people all the time. You know, so maybe I am in a bubble, but I'm not alone in terms of nobody. Just nobody saw this. Now, we had George Christensen right up there in far north Queensland. Now, I don't know if you know George Christensen well in New Zealand, but about 10 days before the election, 20 days before the election, making headlines because it turned out that he'd spent most of his more time in the Philippines with his fiancée, you know, actually in the Philippines with his fiancée, than in the federal parliament over the last 3 or 4 years. You know, front pages, quite a big deal, everybody talking about it. Well, how did he go in the election? 10 points to George Christensen. I mean, What? Where did that come from? Nobody saw it. And maybe part of it was the Adani coal mine. So we've got an issue about the Great Barrier Reef dying before our eyes. The Adani coal mine is a hugely controversial project. About 3 or 4 weeks ago, I guess it was, Bob Brown, the former leader of the Greens, you know, leads this convoy up through Queensland and, you know, saying stop Adani, which was probably felt like a good idea at the time. But in the end, I think for the Queenslanders, and Queensland just rejected the Labor Party. It was a massacre for the Labor Party in Queensland. I think a lot of the Queenslanders saw, you know, this convoy of dickheads coming from the south, taking our jobs, destroying our economy. And that was the way it played among the population.
Is there a sense then that you are in the midst of a shift, that blue-collar voters who were traditionally attracted to the Labor Party and Labor Party's values are now going to the coalition and vice versa for perhaps city elites?
Quite possibly that may be. I mean, people are searching through the entrails now trying to make sense of it. I'll say this, however. I mean, this is the game we're in. I'm not a professional political analyst. I don't you know, go through stat by stat, booth by booth, the electorates. But I'll make this point. I mean, as it is when the All Blacks play the Wallabies, when the All Blacks win 21 points to 20, All Blacks played really well, Wallabies just not good enough. There's only a point in it. All of the analysis would change with just couple of more points. And in this case, it was, you know, there was 180,000 more votes for the coalition than the Labor Party, which in a nation of 25 million is not that much. So all the analysis is about how terrible Shorten was and how brilliant Morrison was. That's the way the game works. But it's look, I wish I had easier answers. I personally am just, like most of the nation, stunned. A lot of the nation is joyous about it because Scott Morrison won against all odds.
Couple of quick final questions for you, Peter. First of all, how did the pollsters get this so wrong? And second of all, what's this going to mean for Kiwis?
Okay, the first question is, those pollsters have got a case to answer. Graham Richardson, famous former Labor Party minister, now a pundit, he made the point not that long ago. He said, listen, you don't lose 50 polls in a row and then win the 51st. It just doesn't happen. He said, you know, Liberal Party's lost this. It's not going to happen on polling day. Well, before our very eyes, I mean, and the bookies had it, I think, at $1.07. Put it, you want to, and everybody said, follow the money. Somehow the bookies know better
they
than
paid
us.
Out early.
And on the night that the polls closed, they paid out early. Nobody saw it coming. I don't think Scott Morrison saw it coming. Second question, what does it mean for the Kiwis? Basically business as usual. I did a report for Foreign Correspondent here at the ABC in Australia on the really hardline regime of deportation of Kiwi citizens, even if they've been here for 50 or 60 years and have got some run-in with the police in their past. Here's your papers, off you go. And it was about, from memory, I think in the course of 3 years, it was 1,800 Kiwis we sent back and we got 9 Australians coming this way. I have no inside knowledge on what the Labor Party would have done. It was not an election issue here because there's no Kiwi votes. But I suspect that the New Zealanders, that if the Labor Party had gone, the regime would have been less hardline than that. So what it means is business as usual. I don't think much will change, that it'll still be a fairly hardline program for deportation of Kiwis that have had run-ins with the police.
Mm. Ngā mihi ki a koe. Thanks very much for your time. We really appreciate it. That's Sydney Morning Herald
columnist. Tell me before we go, what does that mean?
That means thanks very much to you. We can
teach
you a bit
more
if you stick around.
I wish we in Australia had more of Indigenous language.
I think we all do.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
That is Peter Fitzsimons, columnist and the author of The Catalpa Rescue. We thought it would be kind and plug his new book tonight.